Welcome to this lecture on heat transfer, the first in a series of lectures on the mechanism of convection. In this lecture, we'll provide an introduction and we'll explain the conservation equations. The objective, the learning goals, are classification of the physical mechanism of convection and classification of the type of convection problems. That means we'll expect you to understand what convection is and how it is different from advection. Convection is the interaction between heat conduction and advection. Classification of convection problems means to understand the types of problems that we will have in engineering where convection plays a role. The second learning goal is understanding the conservation equations, in particular how to derive the conservation equations for mass, momentum and energy, and understand the similarity between momentum and energy transport. How is heat transferred? Let's look at heat conduction, conduction diffusion. We see a lattice with atoms in the lattice, and it's a solid piece of material, or it can also be a fluid that is not flowing. And we see that there's the molecules vibrate and the energy in the vibration is related to the temperature. The higher the temperature, the more intense the vibration. The energy of the vibration is transferred from one molecule to the neighboring molecule. So that is a very local process. The molecules do not move, make a large-scale motion. And this is a diffusive process. This is heat conduction. Now let's look at a different case. Let's look at a room where we have a window to the right and a heater below the window. We assume that outside the temperature is colder than inside, and we will have molecules near the window that are cooled by the outside. And these molecules, the air will have a higher density, and the air near the heater will have a lower density because it is heated. So the cold air will drop to the floor, the hot air will rise, and together they will mix, and they create a pattern of flow in the counterclockwise direction, where we see inside this flow that we have interaction between hot and cold molecules, and on a large scale we have a motion of the energy, the heat energy in the room. If we now change the configuration, if we put the heater on the left side and the window is still on the right side, then we will see that the cold air drops to the floor, the hot air rises, and we'll see mixing of hot and cold air in a circular motion in clockwise direction, and on the floor we will still have the cold air moving from the window across the floor. So this is a totally different configuration, also from the viewpoint of design. If this were your living room, then you would have cold feet, so that would not be the optimal design. And that is also why in reality you see heaters often placed near a window. We can also look at a very local scale, what happens in terms of the physical mechanism. Let's aim a heat source at a fluid at rest. The heat is transported away from the heat source in the radial direction along the gradients of the temperature, and the colors of the line here indicate the temperature. The law that holds here is Fourier's law, which states that the heat flux per unit surface area is the thermal conductivity times the gradient in the temperature. Now suppose we do not have this local interaction between the molecules. We only have transport by fluid that is moving. That is called advection. We have a flowing fluid flowing from the left to the right, and there's a heat source aimed at the fluid. Then before the fluid approaches the heat source, nothing happens, it is simply cold. Then at the location of the heat source, the fluid is heated, and then the hot fluid is moving away. So the heat is transported by the fluid movement along a flow path, a current path. So, and there is no effect of the disturbance against the direction of the flow, because we assume there is no interaction on a very local scale like we had here in the conduction. The quantity that changes is the enthalpy flow density. And this enthalpy flow density is defined as the product of the density times the velocity times the heat capacity times the temperature. Now, what is happening in a realistic convection problem? There we have both effects playing a role. On the one hand, the heat conduction between the molecules, and on the other hand, the advection, that is the large-scale transport. And that is what we call convective heat transfer. If we then draw the picture of the fluid in motion with the heat source and the lines of constant temperature, then we see that in this case we have diffusive effects in the direction against the flow and also across the streamlines, and we have transport along the streamlines of the temperature of the heat. So we have transport along the flow paths by convection and of course also by conduction, and perpendicular to the current paths in this direction and in this direction we have only conduction. What is the difference now compared to pure heat conduction? Let's look at the case of a hot plate. We have cold molecules above the hot plate that are moving towards the plate. Near the plate, they are heated by the energy of the plate, and then they move away at a higher temperature, driven by the flow. How can we now classify problems according to the flow condition? There are different types of convection problems. The first is what we call forced convection. And in forced convection, the flow is externally driven by the motion of the fluid or the motion of the object. There are two examples of forced convection. The one is where the flow itself is external, and the other is where the flow is internal. External flow means flow around an object, and here we see an example of a turbine blade moving in a hot stream, or the hot stream moving around the turbine blade. And the second case is where we have the flow inside a wall, inside a pipe. There is a cold stream entering a pipe, and it of course exits the pipe at a higher temperature. Here the flow is driven by, for example, a pump. So here we, both cases, we have the flow driven by external means, that is forced convection, and the two types that we have are flow around as external and flow inside as internal. The second type of convection problem is what we call free convection or natural convection. Here the flow is driven by the temperature differences themselves. And as an example, we have here a solar collector. On the solar collector, the temperature is higher, so the solar collector heats the air, the hot air rises, then it is replaced by cool air, and we start to see a flow. And this is a flow around an object, so this is a problem where there is free convection in an external configuration. We can also look at free convection in an internal configuration, that is, for example, in a chimney. Below in the chimney there is the fire that heats the air starts to rise, and then it moves inside this pipe to the outside, and fresh air is sucked in from the inside, cold air that is also moving up. So here inside the pipe we have a flow that is driven by the temperature density differences at the bottom and at the exit of the pipe. So to repeat, we have forced convection and free convection. And in both cases, we can distinguish external flows and internal flows. How do we now describe heat transfer by convection for engineering purposes? And this is done in an empirical way by introducing a heat transfer coefficient. Let's look at the case of a hot plate in which we have a temperature gradient, and above it is a fluid in which we also have a temperature profile, that is from the wall to a temperature far away. At the plate, the fluid will not be moving. Also, when the plate is not moving and there is a flow, there is a boundary condition that says that the fluid adheres to the wall. And we will here have a temperature gradient at y is zero. And this temperature gradient, indicated here, multiplied by the conductivity of the fluid, multiplied by the surface area, is the total amount of heat that is transported from the plate to the fluid. The temperature gradient at the surface will of course be related to the difference between the temperature at the wall and the temperature far away. So we can now assume that we have an approximate linear relation where we write the heat flux as the surface area times the temperature difference times the heat transfer coefficient alpha. So the heat transfer coefficient alpha in fact describes the approximately linear relationship between the amount of heat transferred and the temperature gradient. And this means that alpha is a system parameter and not a material property. The heat conductivity lambda is a material property. The alpha is depending on the flow. If we have a large velocity, then the gradient may be larger. If we have a different object, the gradient may also be different. So the heat transfer coefficient depends on the configuration of the flow. We can also look at the unit of the heat transfer coefficient. The heat transfer coefficient is thus first of all defined as the lambda times the temperature gradient divided by the temperature difference, and its unit will be, and that's what you can see from this relation, it will be watt per square meter Kelvin. So it indicates how much heat is transported per unit surface area per unit of temperature difference. We can write this heat transfer coefficient in a dimensionless way, and that is by taking a reference length L, and then of course we have the conductivity, so we multiply it with the length scale and we divide it by the thermal conductivity, and that gives us what is called the Nusselt number, a dimensionless heat transfer coefficient. And here you can see how it is given. It is the product of the length scale times the gradient of the temperature at the surface divided by the temperature difference. Now suppose that we have a layer of fluid in which the temperature varies, but the layer is not moving, and assume that the layer here will have a thickness of L. In that case, the gradient of the temperature in this layer will be linear. It will be the difference between the wall temperature and the infinity temperature divided by the length. If we substitute that in our definition of the Nusselt number, then we will find the Nusselt number equal to unity, to 1. So this means that we can interpret when the flow is moving and the gradient may be larger, then the Nusselt number will be larger than 1. That indicates then that the convection, the motion of the fluid, enhances the heat transfer. So the Nusselt number can be seen as the amount by which convection enhances heat transfer related to conduction. In practice, what we need to know for engineering is how this Nusselt number depends on all the properties of the flow. And so to see what actually happens in this layer, the boundary layer, that is the near-wall layer, where we have a significant gradient of velocity and temperature, what happens there, we can only understand when we actually solve our equations. So for this, we have to look at the conservation equations that hold in the flow. And in the next part of this lecture, we're going to derive these conservation equations. We have three of them. We have an equation for mass, for momentum, and for energy. What we do is set a balance. First, we define a control volume. And this control volume may be done in two ways. The first is where we have a control volume that is moving with the flow. And this is an approach that you will find in one class of fluid mechanics books. The other type that we also apply here, found in the other half of the fluid mechanics books, is where we have a fixed control volume. And here it is drawn. The control volume is size dx in the x direction, dy in the y direction. And we assume that the velocity in x direction is u and the velocity in y direction is v. Perpendicular to the screen, there is a size of the volume dz. So we have indeed a cubic volume that is our control volume. What we now are going to describe is a general balance, that is a quantity. And this can be the mass, for example. And this quantity in the volume will change as a function of time, depending on what is happening on the sides of the volume, how much of this quantity is flowing in and how much of this quantity is flowing out in each of the directions. So we look at the temporal change of a quantity inside the control volume, That is the net transport of the quantity across the boundaries of the volume. And then for the case of the momentum equation and the energy equation, we have additional terms. For the momentum equation, we have the external forces acting on the volume. And for the energy equation, we have the work that is done by these external forces. Let's look at the conservation of mass that is described by the continuity equation or the equation of mass conservation. First, we have to set our balance. We look at the control volume, and what we expect to see is the change of the amount of mass in the volume as a function of time in relation to the flow in and out on each of the sides of the volume. On the left side, we have a mass flux in the x direction that is moving in, and on the right side, we have a mass flux in the x direction that is moving out. We can describe the mass flux that is moving out as the mass flux in the x direction at location x plus dx and moving in at location x. In the y direction, we will have a mass flow in the y direction at location y. And on top of the volume, we'll have a mass flow moving out at location y plus dy. We can now write the balance that the change of the amount of mass per unit time is the difference between the mass flow that is moving in minus the mass flow that is moving out in the x direction, plus the amount of mass flow that is moving in the y direction minus what is moving out in the y direction. Now, we can write this mass flow as the product of the density times the velocity times, that's the mass flow per unit surface area, times the surface area of the control volume, dy dz. So then we have rho u at x times dy dz, and the rho is also, of course, at the x location. Note that the product of u dy dz is the volume flow. At the right side of the volume, we can write the mass flow, mass flux, as rho times u at location x plus dx times dy dz. And now we can invoke the Taylor approximation to write the mass flow at the location x plus dx as the mass flux at the location x plus the derivative d rho u dx times dx. And we can do the same thing in the y direction. And that is for the mass flux in the y direction. We can write it as rho times v at location y. And on the top, we can write it as rho times v at location y plus dy. And that is per unit area, so we have to multiply it with the size of the area, and that is dx dz in this case. We can again apply the Taylor approximation. Then we can write the mass flux at the top surface at y plus dy as rho v at y plus the d rho v dy times dy, and then times dx dz. If we substitute that in our mass flow balance, first of all, the amount of mass in the volume is the density times the volume. The volume is fixed, so the change of the mass flow in time is the change of the density in time multiplying the volume. We can now substitute our expressions for mass flow at x, mass flux at x plus dx that we have here from the Taylor approximation, and then we see that the net effect is minus d rho u dx times dx dy dz minus d rho v dy times dx dy dz. Of course, dx dy dz is equal to dv, so this term we can cancel. Then we can assume that the density is fixed so that we have an incompressible fluid. And in that case, our conservation of mass equation or continuity equation in the steady state case reads that du dx plus dv dy equals zero. Now let's move to the equation of conservation of momentum. And this is Newton's second law. And here we first of all have to realize that there are different directions. There's an x direction, a y direction, and a z direction. And let's first look at the momentum in the x direction. There is momentum flowing in through the vertical faces, that is the green line here, that is momentum in x direction flowing in the x direction. But we also have momentum in x direction moving in the volume in the y direction. That is fluid that is moving at a velocity u in x direction and velocity v in y direction. Because of the v in y direction, it moves in, but it also has momentum in the x direction. So that is the second, and this is indicated by the red lines. The temporal change when we have a steady state, the momentum in the x direction contained in the volume, the derivative as a function of time, will be zero. So now let's look at the components of this momentum flow. On the left side, we have the mass flux in the x direction times the velocity in x direction, that is the momentum in x direction moving in. On the right side, using the Taylor approximation, we have this same amount of momentum plus the derivative of mass flux times velocity in x direction with respect to x times dx. Now let's look at the second component. Here we have a mass flux in the y direction and it has a velocity u in the x direction at location y. And that is the momentum in the x direction. And at location y plus dy, the top of the volume, we can write it as the mass flux in y direction times the u plus the derivative of mass flux in y direction times u with respect to y, multiplying dy. If we now substitute for the mass flow the product of density times velocity, and then we write our net balance, and we also exploit the fact that we already know that the continuity equation holds, then the net flow of momentum in x direction, the net change of the momentum in x direction due to the flow in and out, can be written as minus rho u du dx plus rho v du dy times dx dy dz. But this was not all. Here we looked at the inflow and the outflow of momentum. For the momentum equation, we also have to look at the effect of the forces. So we need to add the external forces acting on the volume. And the first forces that we have is the pressure. A pressure at x, and on the other side, a pressure at x plus dx. And the net force in x direction of this pressure is the difference, the gradient in the pressure, dp dx times dx dy dz, with a negative sign. Then we have to look at the stresses acting in the fluid. And here I drew the stresses with the green lines, and I drew them as they are defined in the positive direction. So these are the tensile stresses at the vertical faces and the shear stress at the horizontal faces. And this is because we only look at the stresses in the x direction. We have tau xx at location x, we have tau xx at location x plus dx, we have tau yx at location y, and we have tau yx at location y plus dy. The ones on the vertical faces are multiplied with dy dz, the ones on the horizontal faces are multiplied with dx dz, because tau is of course newtons per square meter, and to get a force we have to multiply it with the surface area. If we now do the balance and we look at what we have in the x direction, then what we will get is the d tau xx dx, that's the first term, plus the d tau yx dy, multiplying dx dy and dz. And that is what we get when we apply the Taylor approximation to write the stress here as a function of the stress on the left side. If we are looking at the case of an incompressible fluid, then we can write this effect of the stresses as the viscosity times the second derivative of the velocity with respect to x and the second derivative of the velocity with respect to y times dx dy dz. So this was the effect of the external forces. And if we now add it all together for the case of a steady state incompressible fluid, we can write our momentum equation in the x direction first as on the left hand side the net flow of momentum into the volume. On the right side we can write the pressure difference and the viscosity times the second derivative, the effect of the stresses. And this, because these are second derivatives, is in fact the diffusion of momentum by the stresses in the flow. Of course, we can also add additional forces. We can, for example, add the volume forces due to gravitation. As mentioned, we have the momentum equation. We have an equation for each direction, so we have a similar equation for the y direction, and we have an equation for the z direction. In the x direction, you see that the dominant variable here is the velocity u, in the y direction it is the velocity v, and in the z direction it is the velocity w. In the x direction, pressure gradient dp dx, y direction dp dy, z direction dp dz, and the diffusive term is eta times the Laplacian of the u, the Laplacian of the v, and the Laplacian of the w. Finally, let's look at energy conservation, the flow of entropy. We again define our control volume, and we look at the change in time of the enthalpy in this volume. And the change in time will be rho Cp times the change of the temperature times the volume. And if we have a steady state case, then the change in time of the enthalpy in this volume is going to be zero. Let's first look at the net effect of the flow across the boundaries. On the left side, we'll have the mass flux times the Cp times the temperature that is flowing in. And on the right side, we have the same quantity but at a different location moving out. And using the Taylor approximation, we can write this as mass flux times Cp times t plus the derivative of mass flux times Cp sin t with respect to x times dx. At the bottom side, we have a mass flow in y direction, Cp times t. And at the top side, we have this same amount plus the change that we have as a result of changing the y location. Substituting the fact that the mass flow is the product of rho times u, and substituting that all in a balance, also using that we already know that the equation of continuity holds, we can write the net flow of enthalpy into this volume as minus rho times u times Cp times dt dx plus rho times v times Cp times dt dy, multiplying the size of the volume dx dy dz. We also have to take into account how much heat is entering by means of conduction. On the left side, we have the thermal conductivity lambda times dt dx at location x, multiplying dy dz for the surface area. On the right side, we have the same quantity at x plus dx, multiplying dy dz. At the bottom, we have minus lambda dt dy at y times dx dz. And at the top, we have minus lambda times dt dy at y plus dy times dx dz. Adding this all up, and applying the Taylor, we can write that the lambda dt dy at y plus dy equals lambda dt dy at y plus the derivative of this quantity multiplying dy. Substituting that all for both sides of the volume, we then see that the heat conduction has an effect of the ddx of lambda dt dx plus the ddy of lambda times dt dy multiplying dx dy dz. So this is the amount of heat that is entering the volume because of conduction. If the lambda is constant, it does not vary as a function of the location, if it's homogeneous, then we can of course take it outside the differential, and then we obtain lambda times the second derivative of the temperature plus the second derivative of the temperature with respect to y direction. This is again what is called a Laplacian. And you see that here, this is a term that has the same kind of nature as diffusion. So this is the diffusion of temperature. If we now write our equation in total, we add everything up, then we see that we first have the flow of entropy, the net flow into the volume because of the velocities, which is rho ucp times dt dx, rho vcp times dt dy, plus rho wcp times dt dz. And it equals what is entering by conduction, that is lambda times this diffusive term, the second derivative of t with respect to x, t with respect to y, and with t with respect to z. What we have not taken into consideration now is the work that is done against the pressure, the shear stresses, and the volume forces. That is something that we should add. If we now compare this equation to the conservation of momentum equation, then there we had the impulse, the momentum flowing in, and we had a pressure gradient, and we had the effect of the shear stresses, the diffusion by momentum of the shear stresses. And these equations look remarkably similar, except for the fact that here we have a pressure gradient. If we divide the first equation by rho Cp, then we can divide the conductivity here by rho Cp, and this is the thermal diffusivity, that is a new quantity. And in fact, it describes how strong the diffusivity of temperature is in relation to the enthalpy flow into the volume. If we look in this way at the momentum equation, we can divide by rho. Then we also have to divide our viscosity by rho, which then gives us the dynamic viscosity. And of course, we get a 1 over rho in front of the dpdx term. And then the two equations we can write in the following way. The first one is u du dx, v du dy, w du dz, and this is only for the x direction, minus 1 over rho dpdx plus nu, that is the dynamic viscosity, times the Laplacian of the velocity, and this is the diffusive effect of momentum. In the energy equation, we can write the equation in the same way for the temperature, and there what we can do is we can now replace the A by nu over the Prandtl number, where the Prandtl number is defined as the ratio of the nu over the A. And the Prandtl number then in fact means that we look at the magnitude of the terms, the different magnitude of the terms, of the diffusive momentum transport that is in this equation, and the diffusive heat transfer in the heat transfer equation. So if the Prandtl number is much larger than 1, then this term is much smaller. That means that the diffusion of heat is much slower than the diffusion of momentum. This brings us to the end. So you have seen the similarity between transport of momentum and transport of heat and of energy. And the comprehension questions that are related to this lecture are, first of all, what is meant by a heat transfer coefficient and what does it describe? A heat transfer coefficient describes the amount of heat transferred per unit surface area per unit temperature in a convective flow problem. Why does Fourier's law of heat conduction also apply on the fluid side in the immediate vicinity of the wall? At the wall, we will have a zero velocity when the wall itself is not moving, so that means that we also have exactly the conditions of Fourier's law. Then, what does the dimensionless Nusselt number mean? The dimensionless Nusselt number is a dimensionless heat transfer coefficient, and taken the right quantity of the scaling, the right length scale in it, it explains us how much stronger heat is transferred by convection than by conduction. Then we had different types of convection problems. We have natural and forced convection. So what is the difference? In the forced convection, the flow is imposed by external means, and in the natural convection case, the flow is in fact generated by the temperature differences in the flow because of the density differences that occur. This concludes the first lecture. It has been a bit longer than the lectures that will follow. Thank you for your attention.